following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
And we made it to a Friday. Yeah, the weekend is just about upon us. And boy, do we have our work cut out for us. I'll tell you, this is going to be a three-month stretch for the record books. We have, as you know, a madman in the White House who is bound and determined to burn the place down before he leaves, figuratively. It's the scorched earth policy. Obviously, Donald Trump believes it's my way or the highway. We're going to do things the way he wants them done. And screw the rules. Screw the norms. Forget about the Constitution. He doesn't care because he doesn't know any better. You know, this is the problem. This man pretends that he's educated. I mean, the other day he was trying to smear Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez over her education. And, you know, I love AOC. And she challenged him, release your records, your college transcripts, and I'll release mine. And whoever loses has to fund the post office. Oh my goodness, there's a lot of news to get to today. We also have a special guest coming up, and that is Norman Solomon. Now, if you are a good progressive, you likely know the name Norman Solomon, and I've known Norman for over a decade. And I got to tell you, you know, I can be hot-headed at times. I know that's a shock to hear. But sometimes I speak first and think later. And I've been a fan of Norman Solomon's for many, many years. He is an activist. He's an author. He's a journalist. He was a congressional candidate. He walks the talk and has been for decades. And like I said, I'm a big fan of his. I don't remember what caused the falling out, but he was on the show with me. It's got to be 5 years ago already. And something happened that I got angry and I hung up on him. And I felt bad about it, and especially now that I don't even remember what it was about, because, you know, I can get, it's the Scorpio in me. I can get a little hot-headed, in case you hadn't noticed. Anyway, I wrote to Norman, I don't know, 6 months or so ago, and apologized. And he's like, not that there's anything for you to apologize for. I'm guessing he probably doesn't remember the incident, much like I don't remember what prompted it. But anyway, he was very gracious, and he said, anytime you want me, I'm happy to come on your show. Well, there's a reason I want Norman Solomon to join us today, and that's because of a new campaign that the group that he founded, rootsaction.org, has launched, and it's called Vote Trump Out. I played something from it. It might have been Monday that I played this video they produced as this new campaign launched. So in fact, you know what? I'm going to do it now. I'm going to play it now, even though Norman's not coming on till the bottom of the hour, because I want you to know what this is about. And again, you may remember from when I played this video audio, if you're listening to the audio streams on Monday, and it's a new organization. Well, it's a new initiative, I guess. Again, called Vote Trump Out. Their website is votetrumpout.org. And they have a group of national endorsers who are helping with this message. And basically, this effort is aimed at people like me. And I'm guessing if you're a regular listener of the show, possibly you as well. And who do I mean by that? I'm talking about progressives. I'm talking about people who were Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren supporters during the primary season. I'm talking about those of us who did not think Joe Biden was a good choice and honestly are not that thrilled with Kamala Harris either. But we still have the goal. We need to get Donald Trump the hell out of the Oval Office. So that's what this VoteTrumpOut.org effort is about. So they put together this group of national figures from Addie Barkin. You know who that is. He's a Medicare for All advocate who's been battling ALS. Medea Benjamin of Code Pink, Melissa Byrne, Noam Chomsky, who, by the way, narrates this video I'm about to play for you, Marjorie Cohn, John Cusack, Roseanne DeMauro, Daniel Ellsberg, Jim Hightower, Ro Khanna, Bill McKibben, Winnie Wong. So the names, some are more familiar than others, but the one thing they have in common is these are staunch progressives. These are people, I promise you, not a single one of them ever said, I want Joe Biden for president. In fact, most of them that I'm looking down the list were either advisors to Bernie Sanders or Bernie surrogates. Like me, they believed that this was the time we needed a real progressive. We needed somebody like a Bernie Sanders. But they're not taking their toys and going home. They realize how important it is that we get Donald Trump the hell out of office. And one of the graphics that this group, this Vote Trump Out group, has been using has, let me see if I can't find it. The graphic says, oh, no, I lost, you know what? I bet I have it up here. And I don't, hold on, let me add audio to this shot, and then I can put this graphic on the screen. And it basically says, let's see, it says, vote Trump out in swing states, protest Biden from day one. And then if you saw the show card that I put up, here's another graphic that this group is using, and it says, would you rather protest net zero carbon emission standards by 2030 or protest authoritarian fascism from which we may never recover? Either way, we're going to have a big fight on our hands. Either way, we're going to be pushing back. And look, in 2016, had Hillary Clinton been elected, you can bet that we would have been pushing from the left against the Clinton administration. Well, so now our efforts have just been delayed a little bit. And come January 21st, 2021, hopefully, the first full day of the administration after Trump's, we push hard from the left to get our priorities done. You know, the Democratic Party has been voting on the platform, and I know a lot of people, a lot of progressives voted against the platform because you know what was not included? Medicare for all. So our efforts here are twofold, actually manyfold, but two main areas of concentration. One is don't let up on these progressive ideals, the issues we know are what we need in this country. My God, if we've ever needed universal health care, it's now, as we are the poster child for this global pandemic, that the United States should be leading the world in terms of response on. And instead, we're bringing up the rear. You know, bring out your dead. Not dead yet. You will be soon. So that's one. And the other one, the main goal is, because we can't accomplish anything unless and until we get Donald Trump out of the White House, out of office, get his cronies out of D.C., drain the fucking swamp, because, you know, it's opposite world. Everything he says, just take the opposite of what he's saying. Anyway, so here is the inaugural video released by this group at votetrumpout.org, narrated by Noam Chomsky. And I'm going to turn it up because Noam Chomsky is kind of soft-spoken, so hopefully you can hear him okay. All right, here we go. Roll the videotape.
Another 4 years of Trump may literally lead us to the stage where the survival of organized human society is deeply imperiled. The most important issue that humans have faced in their history is the impending catastrophic climate disaster.
According to a new report, experts say that we have until 2030 to avoid catastrophe.
Trump is the worst person in the world on this issue.
All of this with the global warming and that, and a lot of it's a hoax. It's a hoax.
So we have a choice between trying to find a way to survive or ensuring disaster. That's just the beginning. The traditional left position is you don't vote for, you vote against. It doesn't matter how I feel. It doesn't matter whether you like Biden or not. That's your personal feelings, irrelevant. Nobody cares about that. What they care about is what happens to the world. I have to get rid of Trump, keep pressure on Biden, just as Sanders and associates have been doing. Politics is activism, not taking 5 minutes to push a button. Look what's happening in the streets of the country. The greatest social movement that has ever developed, led by Black Lives Matter, take Sunrise Movement, managed to put the Green New Deal on the legislative agenda. This generation is going to decide whether organized human society can survive. And the crucial part of this decision is to get rid of the major barrier to survival, which happens to be in the White House. Get rid of Trump, then we have opportunity.
Vote Trump out. So there's Noam Chomsky narrating that video. And just like clockwork, sure enough, I'm looking, you know, we're still suspended from YouTube. So I post the shows to YouTube, but I can't stream live there right now. So we're on Facebook Live, we're on Periscope, we're on Twitch. And I just checked in on Facebook, and DL said, regarding my comments, he's like, so we go ahead, give up any leverage once again. No, that's not what I'm saying at all. And that's the very reason that Norman Solomon is joining us in about 15, 20 minutes. So DL and everyone else who feels that way, I really hope you stick around and listen, because this is important. And I promise you, the people whose names I read off, the national endorsers of this Vote Trump Out initiative, are as progressive as they come. They are Democratic Socialists of America. They are, they are staunch opponents to Joe Biden. This is not about supporting Joe Biden. This is about getting Donald Trump the hell out of our lives, out of our government, out of sabotaging what's going on. And make no mistake, he is right now sabotaging the U.S. Postal Service in order to sabotage the election. All right, before we get too far into it, and we've got some news I'll get to for you. You know, I like to start the show with something funny. And we got a good one for you today. She's rapidly becoming one of my favorite YouTube song parodyists. She goes by the name Miss Lori Lenner. Her Twitter handle is And the Band AIDS, AIDES. Her website is MissLoriLenner.com. And here, she takes on Doris Day, who was always one of my mother's favorites, so I have a soft spot there. And, well, you will get the reference here. So take it away, Miss Lori Lenner.
When I was watching my TV, they asked Trump about COVID-19. That's true.
And you have
it,
it is what it is.
It is.
And you
it
have
is what it is.
What it
is.
And when are you getting that support?
And will there be a testing plan, more unemployment, or a vaccine? Person, woman, man, camera, TV. We're lower than
the world.
It is what it is. Now we have children back to school. They ask their parents, what about me? Will we catch COVID? Will we drop dead? Just tell them what Trump said. It is what it is. You might die or you might not. You're more like an afterthought. It is what it is. All the blame is his.
It is what it is.
Leonard, yeah. Oh man, it is what it is. So we've heard. Yeah. All right. She's good, right? She does good stuff. Again, Miss Lehner, LEHNER.com is her website, and she does wonderful parodies like that. That was a good one. I appreciate that. Let's give her a little round of applause, shall we? Oh, here we go. All right. I guess. We should get into the news, huh? Because there is a lot of that going around. So let's take it away.
I read the news today.
Oh, boy. All right. I'm not even going to let Bill O'Reilly in here today because he's getting on my last nerves. There's a lot of breaking news. Let's start with what the hell is going on with the post office. There's a guy at Vice, a writer at Vice, Aaron Gordon, who's been doing some really great reporting. And today he wrote, the U.S. Postal Service proposed removing 20% of letter sorting machines it uses around the country before revising the plan weeks later to closer to 15% of all machines, meaning 502 of these letter sorting machines are being taken out of service. U.S. Postal Service workers told Motherboard, that's the tech arm of Vice, where Aaron writes, that this will slow their ability to sort mail. He continues, one of the documents also suggests these changes were in the works before Louis DeJoy, the top Trump donor and Republican fundraiser, became Postmaster General. The title of the presentation, as well as the language used in the notice to union officials, undermines the Postal Service's narrative that the organization is simply moving equipment around its network to optimize processing. That, as you know, is
bullshit.
That's what it is. Then Maritza Giorgio, who works for NBC in Montana, tweeted, quote, just confirmed with the Montana Postal Workers Union, there are orders for 13 collection boxes to be removed just in Missoula. Missoula, Montana, they're removing 13 mailboxes? The direction came down in mid-July. It's unclear how many have been removed already. The Montana Letter Carriers Union just confirmed the removal of 13 in Missoula, 9 in Bozeman, and orders to remove 3 in Lewiston and 30 in Billings. Montana, where there's a good chance that a Democrat will become governor. This is really weird. WUSA reported Southeast DC residents go weeks without mail being delivered. The Kevin McCarthy apparently today told the Washington Post that Republicans do not support withholding funding from the U.S. Postal Service, and in a break with Trump, urged voters to cast ballots by mail. So there's all this. So, you know, what I wonder is, and then Nancy Pelosi, let me see if I can't find this, tweeted out just a short time ago, the Postal Service is a pillar of American democracy. Trump's assault on U.S. Postal Service threatens to starve it of the funds that it needs to deliver America's absentee ballots. The president's actions and even his own words confirm he needs to cheat to win. And then it's hashtag don't mess with USPS. Well, if that's the case, Ms. Pelosi, why are you on recess? Why, while this all-out assault is going on against the United States Postal Service, is Congress on recess? Get your asses back to Washington and fix this mess. Thankfully, Elizabeth Warren is doing that, or trying to anyway. We're okay here because of a filing from Elizabeth Warren's office. This just happened. Elizabeth Warren's office confirms that the Inspector General for the U.S. Postal Service has agreed to examine DeJoy's changes to delivery, partly with an eye toward looking at the impact on mail ballot delivery. So thank you, Elizabeth Warren, for getting on the case. But why the hell is the House out of session? I get the Senate because that's up to Mitch McConnell. But Nancy Pelosi, bring the House back and fix this. There's no deal on a stimulus. People lost their unemployment extra compensation. They're going hungry. They're going to lose their homes. And Congress is home campaigning? Seriously? I know you always take an August recess, but you can also cancel it. You can also cancel it. There was one more thing I wanted to tell you on this story, and that is David Plouffe. You know, he ran Obama's campaign. I'm not the biggest David Plouffe fan, but he went on Twitter because everyone's asking, what the hell can we do about this travesty, what they're doing to the post office? And here's David Plouffe's 5-point plan. He writes, one, primetime hearings now. Yet why they're waiting till September to have DeJoy in, I don't know. I guess because it's recess time. Two, subpoenas to Trump White House and campaign officials. This is a RICO case. Three, visit local post offices with cameras. Show people what's happening. Four, do events with those getting their prescriptions late. Five, involve governors. And six, no rest, no vacation, go to war for our country. Well, this is war. What are they waiting for? This is what I don't get. And yesterday it was kind of frustrating hearing Howie Klein saying a lot of the Congress members that he speaks to are saying there's nothing they can do. There's got to be something you can do. That's why we voted for you, to work on our behalves, to make sure this kind of shit doesn't happen. So please, do something. Return to D.C. Do your jobs. Save the Postal Service. Save the election. Am I making myself clear? All right. We'll be right back on the Progressive Voices Network. All right. So I think Progressive Voices is in a break right now, and I'm just going to continue with the news while they get their commercials on. So that wasn't the whole post office thing isn't the only big breaking news story happening today. But you know that because every day in the era of dump, there's something else going on. Now, this one's really interesting. The Government Accountability Office. That's the independent investigative arm of Congress. It's supposedly one of the ways that Congress can exert checks and balances over the executive branch, although they haven't proven that they know how to use the tools that they are constitutionally granted, but it's there. So the GAO, the Government Accountability Office, concluded that after the resignation of Department of Homeland Security Secretary Kirstjen Nielsen in April 2019. Remember her? How could you forget? Well, the GAO concluded that after her resignation last April, that an improper succession occurred. So the General Accounting Office has referred to the matter to the Inspector General of the Department of Homeland Security for further review and potential action. What they're saying is that both Chad Wolf, the acting secretary of the Department of Homeland Security, who, remember, has no experience in this realm. He is a lobbyist, first and foremost. That's where his experience is in lobbying. He is not a security expert. He's not a government expert. He's not anything except a flunky of Trump's. And Ken Cuccinelli, that nut job, who is, I don't even know what his current job is, but what the General Accounting Office found is neither Cuccinelli nor Chad Wolf were qualified or are qualified for the positions they are now holding. Of course, A DHS spokesman said, "We wholeheartedly disagree with the GAO's baseless report." A spokesman said the legal opinion has no binding force, but it is likely to raise extraordinary legal questions and invite lawsuits about the legitimacy of actions taken by Wolf and Cuccinelli. But this is to be expected when you have an idiot president who doesn't know what the hell he's doing, who instead of putting qualified people in positions of power, puts cronies in political appointees. It's sad. It's scary. And you know all that. All right. I have, you know, I played for you yesterday the audio of Dump telling Maria Boobs Bartiromo that he says the quiet part out loud. Yeah, of course I'm going to sabotage the Postal Service to make it so that people can vote by mail, because I know the more people that vote, our chances of winning go down. This is my Paul Weyrich impression. The good government syndrome, you know. We don't want everyone to vote. The more people that vote, the worse our chances of winning. That's the Republicans speaking. For the Democrats, the more people who vote, the better our chances of winning. That's why they don't want you to vote. Meanwhile, on this whole subject of vote by mail, the Supreme Court weighed in on this yesterday, and yesterday ruled that Rhode Island can let their voters cast mail-in ballots without in-person witness verification during the coronavirus crisis, rejecting a challenge by Republicans to say, no, if they want to vote by mail, they need to have two witnesses witness their signature. And the Supreme Court said, no, that's ridiculous. The decision marked the court's first ruling on a voter relief policy related to the pandemic. Of course, as you'd expect, Clarence Thomas, Samuel Alito, and Neil Gorsuch dissented, expressing support for granting the stay that the state and national Republican parties requested. You know whose name is missing from that short list there? Kavanaugh. I don't know what happened to Kavanaugh, but I don't know. I don't know. Maybe he's drinking his beer. What else? I already told you about the Postal Service plans to remove hundreds of high-volume mail processing machines. Makes no sense. You know, the thing that's so frustrating, Trump with his gaslighting, is still telling us that, the Democrats are holding up everything. The Democrats are holding up stimulus payments and other stuff. Well, actually, you know, the Democrats included funding for the post office in the HEROES Act, which the House passed back in May. Mitch McConnell has been ignoring it. But those stimulus talks are at a complete standstill right now, and Congress is officially gone for August recess. Let me say that again. The nation is in crisis, besieged by a global pandemic, so mismanaged by those in charge that the United States is the epicenter of the global contagion. And Congress has gone home for the month with no action on providing relief for the millions of unemployed Americans, those facing eviction, lacking health insurance, and food insecurity. The Senate yesterday adjourned until, I think, September 8th without agreeing on a new relief package, suggesting a deal is weeks away at the least. And Congress, the House, is out until September 14th unless they bring them back sooner. Of course, you know, Trump pretended to issue executive orders, you know, to make it all better. But that was all
bullshit.
It's just a ruse, because he lies to the American people every single day, every time he opens his mouth. Ooh, speaking of lying, let's get back to that in just a second.
This is a huge, huge issue.
And we're talking about it. The Nicole Sandler Show on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
So Donald Trump has been doing these, you know, he calls them White House briefing, coronavirus briefing. They're campaign events. It's his commandeered television time every day, because he thinks his numbers were falling because he wasn't being seen enough. Amazing. So I don't watch these things, but I do see the clips afterwards. And last night I was thrilled to see that one intrepid reporter in that briefing room yesterday did the right thing. S.V. Date is his name. And he later said that this is a question he's been wanting to ask Donald Trump for 5 years since he first covered one of Trump's events in 2015. And here is the, it's only 20 seconds. It's short, but it's sweet, and it's oh so good. So take it away, S.V. Date.
President, after 3.5 years, do you regret it all the lying you've done to the American people? All the lying, all the dishonesties.
That who has done?
You have done. Tens of thousands.
Yeah, go ahead, please. Go ahead.
He just went straight to the next question. And if that other reporter had any balls, had any testicular fortitude, that reporter would have said, I'd like to know the answer to that question. You know, the women in the White House press corps seem to have that kind of camaraderie, seem to be doing that kind of a tag team work. But I'm not noticing, a lot of others. And the thing is, if the next person had said, oh, we're going to, I want to ask that question, he would then have just turned to One America News or, Fox, because that's all he's got. Anyway, I see our guest has entered the room, and I'm so excited to welcome Norman Solomon back to the program. As I mentioned at the beginning of the show, it's been a while since we've spoken, and Norman, thank you so much for coming back.
Oh, pleasure, Nicole.
I was telling listeners that we've been talking for years. You've been one of the benchmarks of the progressive community for as long as I've been doing this kind of work. I've always looked up to you. You're an author. You're an activist. You're a congressional candidate. You walk the talk. You always have. And now you're doing something that's really important. And I'm so glad you're here to talk about it. Because as I mentioned in the email, was talking to Howie Klein the other day when the campaign launched for Vote Trump Out. And he started laughing. He said, that is aimed at you. Because he knows I live in Florida. I'm in a swing state. I am not a Joe Biden fan. I worry. I worried that I didn't think that Joe Biden could win. I'm hoping that I'm wrong now. I have concerns over the reasons that I was not a Joe Biden supporter from the get-go. He's not the guy I want to vote for. But now we're at the place where he's the nominee. We have a ticket. And it's a choice between, I hate to say it, again, it's a lesser of two evils. And it's a choice that a lot of progressives have said, I'm not going to make that choice anymore. You know Howie, and Howie's a prime example. He lives in California, and he will not go there. He said, I cannot vote for Joe Biden. But what he almost said yesterday, because he's on my show every Thursday, is, but if I lived in Florida, I'm almost at the point where I would. And I think by the time November 3rd rolls around, he will get there because he understands the importance of getting the menace occupying the Oval Office out of there. So that's what this whole Vote Trump Out initiative is about.
That's right. And you really hit on some key points. And by the way, fortunately, we have a lot of progressive benchmarks out there, people across this country who have been energized to realize what's at stake. Mm-hmm. As Nina Turner says, the former co-chair of the Bernie Sanders 2020 campaign, everything that we love is on the line. Healthcare, education, housing, the environment. That's where we are right now. And discussing swing states is really crucial. One of the misappropriated energies and resources that often go where they're a waste, if not counterproductive, is the matter of trying to persuade people or make the case that given it's a general election, they should vote for Biden. If somebody lives in New York or California or one of the other 35 or so completely safe states determined one way or the other, Alabama or New York, it is such a waste of breath, mine or yours or anybody else, mm-hmm. to tell somebody, listen, you've got to vote for Biden. There is no reason on the planet to. The only reason or rationale I've heard in the past, which I used to think had at least a bit of validity, now I think has none, is the argument that, well, if we can ring up the popular vote, Even if the other candidate wins, at least we're going to have the argument that the Electoral College took it one way, the popular vote took it another way. So we will have some leverage or some political clout.
We've had no leverage for the past 4 years.
Yeah, we've been there twice after 2016. Mm-hmm. So what matters is winning, and winning is about the swing states. So as you mentioned, Florida, Arizona, North Carolina, Wisconsin, Michigan, Arizona, it's a pretty short list. Mm-hmm. And that's where our discussion really should be concentrated.
So you're saying even the, you know, there's the blue states, there's California, there's New York, they're going to go for Biden. They're going to go blue. So there's no reason, if you just can't bring yourself to cast a vote for Biden because it goes against your principles, that's fine. It's not going to make a difference one way or another. But you're also saying if you're in a really red state, if you're in Mississippi or Alabama or Arkansas, don't worry about it either, because there's no way those states are going to go for Biden in the long run.
Correct. Yes, absolutely. And this is a case that on our votetrumpout.org website, we've unveiled the Noam Chomsky video.
I played it at the beginning of the show. So,
oh, how great.
Yes, yes.
And Noam moved from Massachusetts to Arizona. He lives in Tucson now.
Okay.
And he's very outspoken. He says, I live in a swing state of Arizona. I'm going to vote for Biden. Well, nobody has been more outspoken against the neoliberal model and militarism and corporate power than Noam Chomsky. He recognizes what's at stake here. And I think the messaging, it's probably more important how you vote is what you convey to your listeners and viewers across the country. It's that messaging, it's that culture that we need to really create and incubate and bring to fruition in the next several weeks. Voting starts really pretty soon. It starts, I heard, even the end of September, but certainly, you know, October is the new November in some ways. And so people have got to see how short the timeline here and how crucial it is, because I've heard so many people say, and I feel this myself, it is unfathomable to imagine another 4 years of Trump.
No, I do not think we would survive. I mean, just look at what's happening right now. I'm nervous about the next 80 days because the damage he could do is immense. Just look at what's happening with the post office. And what's frightening is hearing the response from some of our elected officials saying, we don't know what we could do about this. Well, the first thing they could do, as I just said, is get their asses back to Washington maybe and not be on recess right now. Is that unreasonable?
No, I think you're being very reasonable. And it's a classic sort of a fascistic move. I mean, we don't live under fascism, but there are very fascistic tendencies. The momentum is in that direction. And some of the measures that Trump has taken are fascistic. And one of the ways to really severely damage the electoral process certainly falls under that category. So this is really a wake-up call. And certainly, there are a lot of people out there who are totally with, we've got to defeat Trump, so we're going to vote for Biden. We're going to urge our friends and relatives to do the same. But there are a lot of folks who see it as a individual matter of conscience, or as you alluded to, it's the often negatively cast term, lesser two evils.
Right.
Well, maybe it's from getting older, or maybe it's just, I would hope, more acuity. But I've come to believe that we live in a constant world of lesser of two evils. When I meet up with somebody who tells me, oh, my conscience tells me I can't do a lesser of two evils, I say, well, how did you get here? And they usually say, I drove my car.
Right.
Well, that means you burned, unless you're rich enough to afford a Prius, that means, which I'm not, that means you chose a lesser of two evils, to put fossil fuels into your car and burn them when you knew the evil of what it's doing in terms of climate. But you figured, since it would have taken 10, 20, 30 miles of walking or running or hitchhiking to get here, you chose that choice of evils. That's the real world. And we do that constantly.
That's right.
And that includes what happens with elections, especially in general elections.
No, all the time. And look, I've said this, I'm old now. I don't know how it happened, but all of a sudden I'm an old lady. And I have voted again, the only time I ever voted for a presidential candidate was in 2008, the first time I voted for Obama, because I believed what he was trying to tell us, what he was saying, which didn't turn out to be true, but I had hope for the change. I bought into it. Although he was not my choice in the primary. Actually, in the primary, I was in Florida. I voted for John Edwards. So, but I like, okay, I bought into it, but, and I thought we were let down, but I voted for him again in 2012. I voted against the other guy every time. Because that's as important.
Chomsky has alluded to, and I think it's in the video. He says the classic left position, we're not in power, is you vote against. You vote against the most odious forces that you recognize, because you realize, as we, I think many people, not enough, do realize now, that we shouldn't have illusions about Trump. He is truly moving this country in a fascistic direction. When we look at the elections, I have a similar feeling to what you articulated. I voted with full enthusiasm, and I guess I am older than you, Nicole, 1972.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't voting in 72. Yeah.
Yeah, it was my first election. I voted for George McGovern, and that was somebody who, in that political context, was heroic.
Yes.
And the news media and corporate power buried him, including a very corrupt labor establishment led by the AFL-CIO George Meany. We lost. We lost badly.
Yes.
But you never know, because we lost terribly in 2016. We now have an opportunity to turn things around.
We do. And again, a vote against Donald Trump is, I believe, right now, even more important than a vote for someone you like. I love you have a graphic that I showed a little earlier. I'll put it up on the screen again now. It says, vote Trump out in swing states. Protest Biden from day one. So this tells me, Norman Solomon, and I hope I'm right, that you have a part two of this initiative ready to fire the day that Biden and Harris win, to start pushing on them from the left to you know, enact the progressive ideals that we've been fighting for so long.
Absolutely. Roots Action, along with many other groups and many individuals, are talking and planning, and some might say plotting, but this is politics. You plan and you organize. Absolutely. Because I think there's a widespread, fairly good understanding, and hopefully become more widespread, that terrible collective mistakes were made in 1993 and in 2009. Mm-hmm. Enthusiasm about ousting some terrible presidents, getting rid of the first Bush, having an end to the second Bush. Of course, we were elated that we no longer had, you know, compared to a Bush, Bill Clinton, or Obama, seemed like a breath of fresh air. However, we let our foot off the gas pedal, so to speak, and corporate power just moved on in.
Yeah.
And Wall Street got bailed out, houses underwater, middle class got screwed, mainstream got screwed up and damaged, and Wall Street made out like bandits. We can't afford to have that happen. And if we can, and I believe we must, defeat Trump, we need to challenge Biden and Harris from day one.
Now, a lot has been made in the news about this new sort of progressive alliance with Bernie Sanders working with Biden and AOC on board on the Green New Deal part of it. And is there really some working together here? I mean, I love Bernie Sanders, and I believe he's doing this for the good of the country, because he knows how important it is we get Donald Trump out of there. Is Joe Biden really listening to Bernie? Is there going to be some collaborative effort there? Do we really, we progressives, have a seat at the table?
I think we have a stool at the table.
Okay.
I don't think it's a full chair.
Gotcha.
Or whatsoever. And we're not in, ironically, even though Bernie has fewer delegates this time with much fractionated field, we're in a stronger position, I believe, with the convention programmatically and beyond. And I think there are a number of factors for that. First is the squad.
Yes.
And the squad is not only four. Now it is growing, and it's growing. Bowman, Bondear Jones,
Kara Eastman,
Bush.
Kara
Eastman. This is very exciting. The squad isn't growing as fast as we would like, but it is growing, and the four of them overwhelmingly reelected. So this is the trend at the grassroots. The polling is clear for Medicare for All, even mm-hmm. though Biden is resisting it. So we have a lot of capacity that we didn't have 4 years ago. And there's also a factor, part of it is because of the wind shift. The wind is at the backs of progressives more than 4 years ago. But also you have a candidate, Joe Biden, who, in contrast to Hillary Clinton, does not hate the left. I think it's fair to say Hillary Clinton despised the left.
Right, right.
By her symbolism and this and that and lip service. I'm not saying she was a right winger. She was a corporate centrist militarist, did not like the left. I don't think that Joe Biden hates the left. I think he just has felt in more than four decades of service to corporate power that he has no use for the left. Mm-hmm. You know, you kind of Delaware, it's in that environment. It's been called the Delaware way. And it's not quite illegal, but as the Nation magazine documented in an article last fall, and even as the New York Times has pointed out in terms of Biden's inner circle in a piece that was published about a week ago, co-written by Astrid Herndon, this is a very corporatized, borderline, you scratch my big money back, I'll scratch yours, political career of Joe Biden. But he doesn't hate the left.
Right.
And he's more of, if you will, a long-term opportunist rather than just somebody who wants to serve the military-industrial corporate complex because he deeply believes in it per se. We don't know about his internal opinions, but we know behavior. So I would just say that there's an opening for all of these reasons and more, and progressives are making use of it. And Bernie Sanders, and I share this feeling. I love Bernie Sanders. Mm-hmm. He has a certain role. His role has shifted in the last few months, and he is not willing or able to challenge the Biden agenda to the extent that I believe we should. And this is one other aspect. When Roots Action in our VoteTrumpOut.org campaign, when we go out to progressives, as we're now doing with full-time people in Arizona and Wisconsin and Michigan, we don't try to sell them that Joe Biden is this wonderful guy. We're telling him that it's essential to defeat Trump, and the only way to do that is to vote for Biden.
You know, you have on the website, votetrumpout.org, a fact page, or fuck him, as I pronounce it, as it looks. And some of the questions you have here are just perfect. You write, isn't a vote for Biden a vote against your progressive values? Because I hear that. So how do you answer that?
Because it's not a matter, I think an answer is it's not a matter of conscience. This is not a matter of, so you feel good about yourself.
Right.
This vote is about what happens to people around this country and around the world who probably are way more vulnerable than you are. Healthcare, education, housing, nutrition, their lives may be at stake. If they're African-Americans, if they're immigrants from south of the border, they're in great jeopardy, made way more jeopardy because of the Trump regime. So I think, frankly, that for a fair number of people who give that argument, oh, in good conscience, I can't vote for Biden, it's sort of a form of narcissism, mm-hmm. I hate to say, mm-hmm. but it's true because like, I want to feel good. I want to feel good. Maybe some of them feel when they go to political heaven, they're going to be waved through because they didn't vote bad. But as Chomsky and others have pointed out, voting is a tool. Voting is a way to get something good done and quite often prevent something bad from happening.
Absolutely. And I also mentioned the group that you identify as national endorsers. Of course, there's Noam Chomsky who narrated that video. But some of these other names on this list are not people you would expect to come forward to say, I'm supporting Joe Biden. Addie Barkin, for instance, who's dying from ALS, who's a huge Medicare for All proponent. Again, Joe Biden is not for Medicare for All. The fact that Addie Barkin is in this group says a lot because he understands what will happen if Trump stays in office. And that means don't worry about Medicare for All. Forget about the Affordable Care Act. It's the only reason that I'm probably still standing here because I fought lung cancer 4 years ago. And the only reason I was able to get insurance then as already a cancer survivor was through the Affordable Care Act. So, it's far from perfect, but I'll take that over what Trump wants to do, which is he's taking it to the Supreme Court to get rid of it, even though he says, I'll sign an executive order to cover your pre-existing conditions because nobody's ever done that before, because he's a fucking moron.
Right, right. A very vicious one in the Supreme Court. Of course, he wants to alter to wave himself through.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right. You have Medea Benjamin, who in a million years, I never thought I would see her on a list of people saying, vote for Joe Biden. But
yes, and again, it's the swing state emphasis. I think right. A lot of the names you mentioned would not have signed on if we hadn't been very explicit, as you mentioned in the website, all of our messaging. We're talking about swing states only.
Yes. And so that lets people off the hook. I mean, if you're worried, and again, in the questions section, you really ask some very good ones, and you have great answers for them. I mean, and some of them I don't agree with, like one, there's no real difference between Joe Biden and Donald Trump. Well, I'm sorry, that's just as the computer says.
It's a ridiculous question, isn't it? But we do hear it, and there are some people who are highly regarded. I mean, well, let's face it, Chris Hedges is a great writer. Mm-hmm. He says this. It's mind-boggling to me, and I've talked with Chris about this, that somebody with such great intelligence, insight, and knowledge would conflate as though there was no difference in policy. It's no difference if you're going to put someone like Kavanaugh on the Supreme Court or put somebody like Kagan mm-hmm. on the Supreme Court.
Right.
We're supposed to believe there's no difference.
Right. That's nonsense. It's just nonsense. So, Norman Solomon, I'd be remiss. You're obviously from California. You ran for Congress from one of the most beautiful parts of my favorite state. So you are familiar with our vice presidential candidate more so than those of us who are not in California right now. Mm-hmm. What's the deal with Kamala Harris? Am I right to be worried, or is you know, I just got to bite the bullet and realize that hopefully she'll do the right thing?
Well, I think, you know, in general terms, if she ever becomes president, if you really were a big fan of Bill Clinton, if you're really a big fan of Barack Obama, you're probably going to be in the same ballpark. The foreign correspondent, Reese Ehrlich, has just published in the last few hours on commondreams.org an article assessing Kamala Harris and her foreign policy. It's a headline, something like, is she a hawk?
Uh-huh.
She's a hawk. She's not the most militaristic, but she's firmly entrenched and ensconced in the military-industrial complex. And that's where she's at. And
right.
I'm not seeing a real difference between her and Joe Biden in foreign policy, or for that matter, Barack Obama or Bill Clinton in their eras. That's just where they are. And we're going to have to organize tooth and nail. On the plus, I mean, like Biden, they're not as crazy and dangerous as Trump in that as mainline Democrats, they support restoring the Iran nuclear deal. They support reinstating the INF intermediate range nuclear treaty, both of which Trump has shredded. So, you know, it's a glass part full, part empty. But when you look at what Martin Luther King Jr. talked about in the last year of his life, what he wrote in his final book, Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community? He called it the madness of militarism. That's Dr. King's phrase.
Right.
And Kamala Harris, she's part of that madness.
Oh, okay. And in terms of here we are in our second, I think, civil rights movement, Black Lives Matter. There's a lot of trepidation about Kamala Harris because, you know, as the meme goes, she's a cop. She was a prosecutor. She wasn't exactly great when it comes to prisoners' rights and prison reform and sentencing reform. But I guess this is where we push her from the left. This is why we have to be organized to, on day one, push back against them. We're going to fight whoever it is, whether it's Trump or Biden Harris. And I'd rather take the fight to Biden Harris than Trump.
Yeah, because Trump's a stone wall. We
right.
can push against Trump as much as we want. And it's just fuel and grist for his mill, red meat for the Fox News crowd. Whereas, as you allude to, Biden or Harris, they're movable on some things. And that's a huge difference. Biden and Harris, they're transactional.
Mm.
And if we were going to overall plot their positions on the graph, probably Harris is a mite better overall, But then Biden is shifting a little because of the power of progressives. And I would just contend that the Nicole Sandler Show and many other media outlets, the aggregate of us, because no one outlet can do it, but the aggregate of progressive media is having a long-term powerful effect on the politics of this country from the grassroots.
And that's that. That's the power we have, and that's what we need to harness. And again, we're going to fight back. As you put it in one of the other graphics, you can either protest net zero carbon emission standards by 2030 or protest authoritarian fascism from which we may never recover. There's no choice there. You know, and then I just see this across my desk just this afternoon from The Nation magazine, a story by John Nichols, that the Working Families Party endorsed Biden and Harris. And it says, beating Trump is the priority, but the progressive group says it'll keep pressuring Biden to move left on economic, social, and racial justice issues. So that's what we do for the next 4 years and then some.
That's right. The most optimistic scenario is to parallel to Franklin Delano Roosevelt, elected in 1932. Nobody thought he would be a great progressive president. He came in as kind of a centrist, but movements pushed him leftward, and he had the human capacity to move with the necessities of humanity.
That's awesome. So so this obviously is keeping you busy, Norman Solomon. Again, the website is votetrumpout.org. Please share it with people. I mean, again, as Howie said, this is tailor-made for me. I know it's tailor-made for a lot of my listeners and for people who may not listen. So this is what, you know, we need to call on those of the listeners out there who know such people who are on the fence, who are on in swing states, who can make a difference here, and show them why this is important. Send them the link to votetrumpout.org.
That's right. And something that everybody listening and watching can do is when you go to votetrumpout.org, you can share the Chomsky video from the homepage and you'll help spread it around.
Absolutely. And that's what we need to be doing. Norman Solomon, it's great to talk with you. And I again, I don't even remember what happened years ago. And I apologize for my, you know, mood. I'm a feisty, bitchy woman. And sometimes
I just call it assertive and well-informed and part of the progressive movement.
Awesome. Because if we can't fight between us, you know, I need to temper it a little more. So I so appreciate you coming back and not holding any grudges, because I know whatever it was, I was in the wrong.
I don't know, but as the Brits say, not at all. And it's really a pleasure to talk with you.
And you as well. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for doing this. Again, votetrumpout.org and visit rootsaction.org, because that's sort of the parent organization from which you've been running a lot of wonderful activist campaigns for years and years. So thank you for continuing to walk the talk.
Thank you. And likewise to you, Nicole.
Thank you so much. Norman, it's great seeing you again. And hopefully we'll talk again soon.
Yeah. All right. So take care.
You too. Bye-bye. That was great. That was very special. I feel so much better. I'm one of those people. I'm hot-headed. I've got a temper. My father had a temper. It's, I hate to blame it on the month I was born, but it's a Scorpio thing too. And sometimes I act first, think later. And then I'm embarrassed. So sometimes it's better to be the bigger person. Like, I apologize to Norman for whatever I did to make me hang up on him all those years ago. Also to say, Joe Biden wasn't my first choice, wasn't my second. Damn, he wasn't even my fifth. But the most important thing right now is getting rid of Donald fucking Trump. So I am in Florida. I will vote for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, and then I will work my ass off to change the Democratic Party from within. I will be a new precinct committee person in my district here in Broward County, because I want to affect change from within. I want to move the party to the left. I want to make it the progressive powerhouse that it should be. It's what I talked with Thomas Frank about just the other day. And by the way, that interview ran long. So those of you listening on the Progressive Voices Network, tune in tonight to the Bradcast, which airs at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific on the Progressive Voices Network, or go to bradblog.com. I'm guest hosting for Brad and Desi tonight and running the entirety of that Thomas Frank interview for the whole hour, which you need to hear because it piggybacks right on this conversation with Norman Solomon. All right, so I'll see you there tonight and back here on Monday. Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend. Keep the faith and let's do the right thing and vote Trump out. All right, have a great weekend. I'll see you later. Bye.